quicker. I flows, so one of my shows wouldn't be clever to miss. I'm leaving competitors pissed, to tell you the truth, it gets no better than this. I'm catching racks at the break of dawn, and this song, yo, it's a must that I put it on.
Yeah, so put it on, Big L, put it on, come on, put it on.
Yeah, I started rhyming in 1990. Hold up.
Really?
Yeah.
But how about like when you was a shorty in the third grade, fourth grade?
I was rhyming, but I wasn't saying my own rhymes. You know,
nah.
I was citing records.
It's like I've been into rap ever since I can remember, since a small child. If you look in the CD, and you look at the pictures in the CD, you see a small picture, you know, I'm like 5 years old, and I have a mic in my hand, and I'm rapping.
Really?
I didn't write my own rhymes, but I knew other songs, and I was just like, we had DJ equipment, and they just played an instrumental, and I could just sing the whole song, somebody else's whole song. I knew it word for word. Then in 1990, like around 5 years ago, that's when I started writing my own rhyme. And then I used to like get into like rap contests, talent shows, and things like that. I used to win like rap contests.
Amateur battle, first place, 1992. We beat out like 2,000 dudes, man. That's it. He's proud of this.
I used to rap at all the parties.
Running house parties, the concerts and all that. Then one day I met Finesse in a record store. I told him Nice put me on. He told me to drop for him. I dropped. He liked it. We exchanged numbers.
I was at an autograph signing. I was at an autograph signing. I'm signing autographs. Two kids walk in. It's him and his man.
Okay.
You know, this dude, he cool. He liked the funds. He ain't want to walk up on me. He sent his man over. So his man is like, yo, this dude, my man, it's Nice, he wanna rhyme for you. So, you know, he's like, you know, telling me that. And I'm like, well, so I'm gonna reach out to my manager. And if my manager says he's Nice, then I'll check him out and we'll go from there. So he goes over and tell L, you know, yeah, he said, you know, so L sends him back. So my man said he'll rhyme for you right now. And if you don't like him, he won't ever bother you again. I'm like, is that so? So he rhymed for me, and when he finished rhyming, he was so nice, I was asking for all his numbers.
He's playing a freestyle L first rhyme to me when we was in the back of the store.
Yeah.
That's what he rhymed to me. He was 16.
Rock the rock and will, hard tack tape. I go like this. Hey yo, I got the gift, the gap to lift and grab the mic and recite hype rhymes that'll rip and rag and drag a fag MC who likes to nag a lot and brag a lot, talking about the lyrics that he have behind.
Who's some of the people you idolize?
Definitely Kane, you know what I'm saying? Big Daddy Kane, you know what I'm saying? And I was my man for a long time.
I would go get him from school. Like, he would call me, I got a half a day today, what you doing? And it's like, yo, nothing. And it was funny because I lived on 58th and 10th. So, you know, after 72nd Street, 10th Avenue turns into Amsterdam. And his school was on 107th and Amsterdam. So I used to go straight up 10th Avenue and snatch him up. And he would hang out with me for the day. But, you know, the dude was always writing rhymes, always. I mean, even when I told him I'm quitting, you know, I'm good, man. You got it locked. You gonna do you. Nah. You gotta keep it going. What you talking about, man? You the reason why I'm doing this, man.
He started letting me open his shows.
I put him on, like, my first single.
I first got my start like in 92. I was on a single with Lord Finesse. Lord Finesse, a remix single that was called the Yes You May Remix.
I gave a lot of black eyes in my extorting days. Fucking with me, a lot of niggas sporting shades. That dude, he was just way ahead of his time.
Favorite Big L line? Shit. He had so many. Know what I mean? Like I said, I gave a lot of black guys in my extorting days. Fucking with me, a lot of niggas was sporting shades. I grabbed the microphone and scar jerks. Rappers talk about put me on. What the fuck is it, scar jerks? Know what I mean? He had a couple joints. That, like, he was the punchline king.
It was like, it was an MTV interview that I was doing, and I brought him to the interview.
Yeah. Yeah. What up, Crazy King? That Crazy Old Chill, and he brought Mickey.
Mickey's the illest kid in the world, man. What's up, man?
Big L.
What up, Big L? Have a seat, man.
MTV Raps, Dr. J, and Lovers. Look at Big L over there. That's Big L. Sitting over there in the corner, grimacing at the camera menacingly, about ready to kill something. I don't know why. But this is Lord Finesse right here, and he's our star of the show today now.
Lord Finesse brought him into the fold. Mm-hmm. You listen to a lot of early Big L. He sounds like Finesse.
Yeah.
And then, you know,
there was a style that was developed.
No, the punchline style.
So in the early stage, he was like, him and Finesse was like, you know, they had the same type of rhyme style, and then he just started coming up.
And, it took a while. It wasn't easy to get him on at that time. It wasn't like he was on right away.
Yeah.
It took a minute because people said, well, he sounds just like you. And I'm like, y'all don't get it. For him to be this young and this crafted at this age, he's only going to be greater when he gets older.
I can imagine.
And then he introduced me to Showbiz and AG, and they also put me on their album. And then we shot some demos and had like a big buzz in the industry.
And he rhymed for Finesse, and Finesse called me and was like, yo, this guy's crazy. So after Finesse met him, and Finesse brought him to me, and we took him to Jazzy J's studio, and we started doing demos from there. Then Finesse started taking him more onto the road and doing things, and then I went and got him a deal on Sony, Columbia, and then that was that. But it came from Finesse meeting him down in Harlem while he was at Rockin' Well, and Finesse Big L approached him.
How did you and Finesse meet?
Oh man, we grew up together.
Yeah,
we was in the same school, same everything. We was in the same hood. Finesse, Fat Joe, and Diamond, all of us from the same block.
Same block.
Yeah. We all knew each other since we was kids.
Then right after that, I was on Showbiz and AG first album, Runaway Slave. That first album on a track called Represent.
Big L, give it up. I'm like, oh, my attention went from here to there. Like, you know what I'm saying? I think that went with everybody, man, because he really was like, came out of nowhere with the way his bars was in his delivery.
The first time Big L was heard on Wax was on my album, even though it was a skit.
Right.
On Stunts, Blunts, and Hip Hop.
Yo, this is the big motherfucking L, you know what I'm saying? And I'm glad to say that real rap is back and that wick-whack bullshit is gone. Peace.
And then I got Big L to rhyme on the Five Fingers of Death, which was on my second album. And that came out like 97, 98. So we did work together, but I never did anything on his album.
Right.
He was on my album.
Right.
You know what I mean? So
do you regret never being able to do like something specifically for
my fault. I rhymed with Big L and OC on a song called Get Yours.
Right.
That was on the Black Mass soundtrack.
Okay.
You know what I mean? But yeah, I definitely wish I could have, you know, produced a joint or two on his album. You know what I mean? But we were all around each other, so you know, I am blessed to have worked with him. At least on my project and that soundtrack.
You know what I'm saying? Then I came out with a little promotional single called Devil Son in 93.
I did Devil Son, man. I ain't gonna be responsible for that shit.
Remember the first time I heard? When I was 12, I went to help her stuff in Jesus. When I was 12.
Yo, this dude is crazy. When he told me the rhymes to that shit, I said, yo, you really gonna say this shit on Wax, man? he said, man, I don't give a fuck.
When I was 12,
I went to help
for stuff in
Jesus.
When I was 12,
I went to help
for
stuff in Jesus.
Yeah, Vinny.
I'm waving automatic guns and nuts.
I'm explaining the story. Check it out.
I'm waving automatic guns and nuts.
Ayo, 5/3/0/7/4. A little bro was born with the mind of a psycho. They first knew I was a crazy nigga. When my mother came home and found out I killed the babysitter. I did more crime in due time. Started my life of crime. About 9 going out for mine. I made every little kid from my hood run. I was just like that little bastard from the Good Son. And my mind was past bunk. Dropped the blow dryer in the water while my mom's in the bathtub. Then I just saluted as she electrocuted. Think I booted, cause that's another I executed.
I went up to Sony, right? We played this shit for the dude that was in charge, right? I don't know if he was some satanic worshiping motherfucker.
He was probably like, yeah.
Daddy, yeah. Like, yeah, this is the shit right here. We gonna put this one out first.
I heard this dude do Devil Son. I was like, yo, this guy is a man. And because of that, it's like there's no way I did not want to be a part of it. Plus, when you're down with Lord Finesse, who's a true lyricist, you gotta know that it's on the pop with recognizing talent. And they recognize his talent, and then he took it to the next level.
Tuck me into a session with Big L at the time. What was like? What made him, I guess, an incredible MC artist?
his personality. Mm. Like, if he couldn't be a rapper, he would have been a hell of a comedian, you know, because every session, it was always really comical and funny. Mm. You know, it would be times of being serious, but then it's like it would be little episodes where something happens or he says something or he does something, and it just makes everyone laugh, and he does it so seriously.
Big L joke all day, man, nonstop, man. Big L joke so much, you used to have to... Know what I mean? You used to want to fight L sometime, man. L won't never stop. Know what I mean? Straight up comedian.
I really got to appreciate what he puts into it. I saw him rehearse a song for like 3 hours. One song. Yo, we going over. Nah, I'm chilling. I'm good. But he don't do it in front of people. That's his style. Like, he'll make you think he just remembered this shit out the blue. But he really put a lot into what he was doing. But he just didn't show you. It just seems effortlessly to him and easy. But he definitely worked hard at it. And that's made me really appreciate even more. Because he has a style, a personality that he looks like he don't care about nothing. He just chill, slow motion. But he was definitely passionate.
Our station was in Harlem. He was like the mayor of Harlem. So L could come through any time. And he...
And spit forever,
too. Kill it every time he did. He didn't have to call. He could just show up. He was the one artist... Actually, there are a few artists that didn't need to be invited or didn't need to be on the guest list. He was one of them. Mm-hmm. He brought Jay-Z up the first time.
Really? Yeah.
First time Jay-Z was on the radio was on our show, and it was really because L brought him up.
I got styles you can't copy, bitch. It's the 666 in the mix. Straight from H and double hockey sticks. I'm the devil's son. Like my song said, I smash niggas like cornbread. You can't kill me. I was born dead. I wash it up like a floodage. Me and my crew build caps and carry gats like it's luggage.
What I wish I had was the battle between him and Jay-Z. Before they did the Stretch Armstrong and Bobbito show, they battled in Harlem. He battled Jay-Z in the earlier years. And that's where the respect from Jay comes from with L, because he battled L.
Yeah, so tell me a little about the Diggin' in the Crates crew, you know? Who's in it, you know, some of the members?
All right, Diggin' in the Crates crew, you know what I'm saying? It's a crew that's representing the world. I'm definitely gonna be representing a while back, you know what I'm saying? It's me, which is the newest member of Big L. Got my man Lord Finesse, Diamond D, Phat Joe, Showbiz, and AG. Got my man Buck Wild, more production, you know what I'm saying? It's a nice little tight crew, doing their thing.
Who's the backbone of Diggin' in the Crates? Would you say Lord Finesse?
I say, like, Lord Finesse is the one that put everybody on.
Right.
If it wasn't, you know, for Lord Finesse, you know,
I mean, just break down
show
the...
wasn't no Big L.
So how you come to call yourself Big L?
That was just like a nickname that was given to me a while back, you know what I'm saying? When I was even smaller than what I am now, you know what I'm saying?
Mm.
Hold up. Because they looking at me like Big L, think they're going to get some 6'6", hold up, 250 pounds and all that, but you know, I'm a slim guy.
I know him as Big L, the rapper, the legend. Harlem's final. We know him as the comedian, the troublemaker, the instigator. That's the instigator, you know, because it's like no matter where we hung out, he got a kick out of getting under your skin.
He's a big gambler. You know, Big L would gamble all the time, and, you know, he would fight niggas, like big niggas. I'd be like, yo, L, could we just go shoot the block up? He'd be like, nah, I grew up with these niggas. Just come stand by me, I'ma fight. Every time I went to Harlem and see Big L that he was gonna fight, Vito, he would fight a nigga your size, like the biggest nigga in the world. He's like this, fuck that. I'm like, oh my God, like, yo, L, could we jump this nigga, man? Could we fucking hit him with a bat? No. You know, he was a fair and square dude. Big L was a fair and square dude. He'll fight the biggest nigga in the world, man. It's crazy.
When I started doing Crazy Like a Fox, I told Flavio that I wanna hire Diggin' in the Crates to produce it. Because they got a gang of producers, and I wanted to bring that sound to New Jersey. So I got Buck Wild, Lord Finesse, and Buck Wild, Law Finesse, and no, it wasn't Diamond D, it was Buck Wild, Law Finesse, and Showbiz, all in the studio together.
Ooh.
They was just in there banging out beats, and I was just jumping in the booth on all of these joints. We was doing skits and all kind of fly shit, and
that's
Big
crazy.
L was in there getting on my damn nerves with his antagonizing ass and shit. That little motherfucker was coming to the studio, and he, you know, he was our little brother, so he was acting just like that. Yo, Buck. yo, who you think is better, Rakim or G-Rap? And then he would go into, and, you know, he would say, I think Rakim is better than G-Rap. And just as he would say that, I was like, nah, I think G-Rap is better. And then they would look at me like, why the fuck would you say that? And next thing you know, he start going off. He never let the subject go. And then I say, okay, you know what? You're right. Rakim is better. Then he's like, nah, but G-Rap really is better, though. And I was like, motherfucker, you just argue with me for like 25 minutes about this shit. Now you're going, you know, like he would just do shit to fuck with you. But what was so beautiful about that is Big L would take your mind off of whatever you was thinking of and put you in another place. And then you all of a sudden start rapping about shit that just, you know, just reality, just the reality.
Focus on the real. Big L gives up a clear view of lifestyles of the poor and dangerous. The debut album from Big L, the newest member of the Diggin' in the Crates crew, features top-notch production from Buck Wild, Lord Finesse, Showbiz, and Craig Boogie. Big L, lifestyles of the poor and dangerous, cause it's like that on Columbia.
Tell us a little bit about the album. You know, you got your new album out.
Yeah, I got an album. It's called Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous. Brand new. It's in stores right now. So, you know what I'm saying? Go get it. You know what I'm saying? Buck Wild did the production. Buck Wild, Lord Finesse, and Showbiz. Showbiz and AG. You know what I'm saying? You know, they got the fat beats. I got the fat rhymes and put it together. That album. Yeah.
Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous. Yeah. Who in the hell is all them brothers standing behind you on the cover, man?
Oh, yeah, that's my crew for 139 and Linux, the NFL crew. Yeah.
NFL?
Yeah.
So what's the projects for the future? You know, what you working on in the future coming up?
Yeah, right now, you know what I'm saying? I'm just touring right now with Biggie Smalls and Frank Mack, you know what I'm saying? It's all good, you know what I'm saying? I got a single out right now. It's called Put It On, you know what I'm saying? I got my man King Capri doing the chorus. You know what I'm saying? It's real fat, fat video and all that. Y'all got it.
Yeah, we got it. Put it on.
On and on. I'm feeling that. You feeling that, D?
No doubt.
No diggity doubt.
Live on Video Music Box, we got my man Big L, who be putting it on with King Capri.
No doubt.
Representing the real, Lennox. Let him know.
139 and Lennox, the danger zone, all right? Check the video out, it's fat.
Hey, yo, I was watching it. I was looking at the source, and they gave me four mics and all that. They gave me mad props, portable. What's up? Who you represent and, you know, what it's about? Let them know.
I check it out. I got a brand new single. It's called Put It On. It's in stores right now. Produced by Buck Wild. We got an LG remix. I'm representing Diggin' in the Crates. My man, Fat Joe, Diamond D, Show, Biz, and AG. My man, Lord Finesse, he's right there. All right.
Check this out. If you ain't go out there and cop it yet, my man Big L put it on. One of the nicest MCs, Brother Spear, D-I-T-C, recognized. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I forgot to tell you, my man King Capri, he did the chorus.
Big L, I have met Big L through Buck Wild and Diamond D, and, you know, the whole nigga in the crate situation, Lord Finesse. And he was just one of the coolest dudes. If you hear the way he rhymed on the records, you think that he was a killer. You think that he was straight gangster. And if you met him, he was a totally different person. He was like a little brother, like, you know, and just sad to see him go like that, especially for something that wasn't really his fault. You know, and I used to always tell him, like, you know, you're a star, you're a big dude. Don't stay in these streets right now. Like, concentrate on your music and do your thing. But he loved his people so much that he just wanted to be around them so much. And that's cool, you know, it's honorable. But you know, the streets don't love you back like that, you know what I'm saying? And it's a sad thing that he was gone so soon to get a chance to really see how far he could really go. And being that he was so great at what he did, the fans automatically
took his album, his next album, The Gold, and kept it around and put it on record. You know, I try to give as much life as I can to it when I do my shows and feed it to the crowd as much as I do. I sing, sing the hook still and everything like that. Just in the name of him. He's definitely a great artist.
Yeah, I got the second single off the album, Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous. And the second single is called MVP, which stands for Most Valuable Poet, you know what I'm saying? And you can check the remix, you know what I'm saying? And the remix video is real fat. The truth. Everything is the truth. I got a song on there, you know what I'm saying, called No Wins, No Skins. That's the single. You know what I'm saying? That's the truth. You know what I'm saying? Got a song called Fed Up With The Bullshit. You know what I'm saying?
Shiznick.
Yeah. That's about, you know what I'm saying, about cops. You know what I'm saying? Always trying to mess with a brother. You know what I'm saying? I'm fed up. You know what I'm saying? Cab drivers don't want to stop for a brother. You know, stuff like that. You know what I'm saying?
That's
and
real.
I got a song, what else? Another joint called, what? I Don't Understand It. I don't understand how garbage rappers, you know what I'm saying, be going platinum. And brothers like G-Rap, you know what I'm saying, Granddaddy IU, my man Law Finesse, don't even go gold.
I got a joint called 139 and Linux is the danger zone. Word up, that's where I'm from, the danger zone, 139 and Linux. And that's basically just talking about where I'm from.
Alright, what's that, the danger zone?
Because it's very dangerous around here. That's why I named my album Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous, because when you're poor, you become dangerous. Because you gotta eat, you know what I'm saying? And we ain't just type of brothers that's gonna wait around and wait for a piece of steak to come falling out the sky, you know what I'm saying? We're gonna do what we got to do to get that money so we can eat, you know what I'm saying?
The dude was, he was special. I mean, we say it all the time how special he is, but I don't think he's gonna be any more special to y'all than he is to us due to the fact is, you know, we personally know him, was always around him.
Your memories, bro, about 97 when we first met, when you you and Big L, rest in peace, came to Zagreb, Croatia.
And good looking out to all the fans out here in Croatia, you know, that supported me and supported my clique. You know what I'm saying? DITC forever. And I'd like to say thanks, you know, for all the support y'all showed the crew and everything.
Any memories from that trip?
I remember being on the road. And actually, that spot in Croatia wasn't even one of our stops. And you made it happen. I guess you found out we was out on the road. And I just remember that not being one of the stops. And you made that happen. Pulled the rabbit out your hat. Got us to Croatia. That was probably one of my best shows. Well, for me and L, ever. You know, overseas, and it's just everlasting memory in my, it's burnt in my brain, you know what I mean? Like, the crowd was crazy.
I want y'all to say O.C.
O.C.
Yeah, and, yo, I want my Brooklyn side on this side to say Big L.
Big L.
Oh, no, one more time, we gotta outdo that side. Say O.C.
O.C.
Yeah.
Hold on. I want you to come back on this shit, though.
Let's get
the names.
Let's get them all to say something.
We're going to go like this. Hold on. I want you to come back on this. Nah. You always start this.
Hold on.
I want everybody on this side to say, fuck that side.
Fuck that side.
Since you always started that shit. So, it was just crazy. You know what I'm saying?
It was my first show that I ever promoted. So I was learning my game, but it was really cool because you spent a couple of days in Zagreb. We had a chance to chill, get to know L.
So like a couple years ago, you released your first joint, Lifestyles of the Poor and Dangerous on Columbia. It was one of the tightest underground albums. You even got like 4 ratings in the Source and everything.
Yeah, it was real tight, you know what I'm saying? I felt like the album was kind of before its time, you know? It was real tight, though, you know? Got a lot of sales, 4 mics from the Source, you know? Put 2 videos out, you know? We released a couple of, you know, white labels and everything. And it was real successful. It was a success and everything, you know? It gave me a chance to, you know, go around the world and meet a lot of different people, you know, see a lot of different markets and everything, perform, and I'm just loving it, yeah.
And the last shit that we heard was that Enemy with Phat Joe. It was kind of hot.
Yeah, good looking out, yeah. We just in the studio one day, you know, recording the album in our premiere, you know what I'm saying, just walked in and had a track. You know, it was coincidental, you know, and he played it, and we just laid it down right there, you know. We just laid it down. You know, I had a rhyme, Joe had a rhyme,
We thought of the chorus. Premier had the beat. Right on time, you know.
And then, you know, Big Al was my little brother. He looked to me for mentorship, and he would always come to me and be like, yo, bro, what's up? It's a song with me and my brother Big Al. He's the only artist I ever did a song with, you know, who threatened me before I did the song with him. And so we recorded the song, The Enemy. Primo did the beat. We was in D&D. Big Al was like, yo, man, you went gold. I'ma rip you down on this fucking song right here, man. I'm taking your 500,000 fans, nigga. I'ma kill you on this song. I'm like, yo, this nigga Al is fucking crazy, man.
So tell us exactly what was going on with you at your label and what's going on now.
Yeah, I don't even want to talk about the past right now. All right, you know what I'm saying? I got something new coming out.
We putting out our own records and selling them. And I'm about to start my own label, Flamboyant Records. So, you know, check me for that.
So what, after years of experience, you're just saying like, yo, let's just control our own and yeah, make it happen that
I
way.
I can put out a single now. Yeah. When I want to put out a single, I can shoot the video to what I want to shoot the video to.
And make the single that you
want
to make.
Exactly. Yeah. I don't have no A&R telling me, nah, you know, change the rhyme. I don't want this. I want, you know, we do what we want to do. Because, you know what I'm saying, how you gonna let, I mean, you know, they never sold a record in their life. Never was no MCs or nothing and gonna tell me how to make a record.
And like, boom, you can make some money if you're controlling your own. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
no, no
yeah,
little
yeah.
8% or 10%. You can make the real deal.
Sure, yeah, 50%.
Straight up.
You know what I'm saying? That's better than 7%.
Yeah,
you know?
Man, after recouping, you know what I'm saying?
You was telling that you were trying to establish your own underground label plus the clothing company. So can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, in 98, you know what I'm saying, look forward to seeing Flamboyant Records, Flamboyant Entertainment, Flamboyant Wear. It's going to be on, you know. Right now, I'm just getting everything done, getting the paperwork done, you know, gathering everybody up, you know, that I want to be a part of, you know, the little organization. And we're just going to take it from the bottom up, you know. But next year, we're definitely going to make noise. Flamboyant everything. Everything. Might even have Flamboyant production companies, everything, you know.
My recollection of L doing the Columbia deal, getting out of that deal, and the transition of lyricism between that time and going into Flamboyant and, you know, the Ebonics. Mm-hmm. Like, I seen the paradigm shift with him.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he was on the Devil's Son shit, but then he was in his bag. And I was like, wow, you know what I mean? Like, I got to step my game up, you know what I'm saying? I seen him progress in such a short period of time.
You can look forward to, you know, my man McGruff coming out, you know what I'm saying? He going to represent Harlem. You know, I'm on a cut with him, you know what I'm saying? A couple of cuts with him. And, you know, Harlem on the rise. And the question that you had asked AG about, you know, about like trying to like adapt to the game.
Yeah, how
well,
it is now.
Like right now, it's like I felt the game is like adapting to me. Because I was stuck for a minute. In that little jiggy, too jiggy, you know what I'm saying,
okay.
Time, that little jiggy period where, you know, you had to come with, you know, singing in your joints and all that.
Yeah.
So I kind of, you know, I was stuck. I didn't know how to come because that ain't me.
Mm-hmm.
But DMX came in the game, you know what I'm saying, Cam, Nori, they changed the game. And they just,
boy,
they set it up for me.
I was just wondering
they
if you
set
could
it right up for me, believe that.
You know, the funny thing, I was outside in Harlem and he walked by. You know, he just walked by, and me and my friends seen him. We was like, you know, yo, that's Big L. So we kind of like, yo, we want to holler at you. And he just turned around. I was like, yo, I got some beats you want to hear. He was like, all right. We went up to my mom's crib, and the first beat I played was Ebonics. And I put it on a cassette tape for him. And then he called me. He was like, yo, can I record it in your house to see how it sound? We recorded it, and I guess he must have let Phat Beats hear it, and then they gave us a budget to go to Premiere Studio.
Good things come to those who wait. True. You know, they say the, you know, later the dinner, the greater the winner.
Right.
You know?
Right. And what's about to come out?
Yeah, I got this joint, you know what I'm saying? Hot, it's called Ebonics. It's crazy. It's like explaining all the slang, man. It's like, you know,
criminal slang.
No doubt. And on the B side, size them up. Two thug party joints, you know? That, you know?
Who produced those joints?
Yeah, it's like me and my man Rondell, you know. We collabed and did it up.
A lot of cats be frontin' with mad singles with a 50 on top. L trying to have this city on lock. Piece to Biggie and Pac, cause they really were hot. Rap game heavy hitters, it's a shame they no longer with us. Niggas wanna be out, ladies wanna see out. If I go to jail, you'll get a shirt saying free out. What? Punks. Yeah. Yo, all my wolves in the house, are you live or what? See, Harlem about to get it all, lies on us. Only ghetto niggas shine, who gon' rise with us? In the first cattle act, we gon' size them up. All my wolves in the house, are you live or what? See, Harlem about to get it all, lies on us. Only ghetto niggas shine, who gon' rise with us? In the first cattle act. Hey yo, I hear a lot of bitch in your talk. I see a lot of switch in your walk. And only thugs get rich in New York. Time is running out. Niggas like L, when you coming out? Cause they sick of all this drag queen shit. Your wife missing, I'm the nigga he was last seen with. Me and N hit it up.
No, he'd be on the phone with Dame Dash, like, yo, I'm about to sign a Rockefeller. He's like, yo, it's gonna get crazy.
I wanna know, was Big L really gonna sign the Rockefeller, man? Absolutely. I wanna know stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah, that's what, yeah, Big L was gonna sign.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, he was, we were talking about, he was always, you know, like I said, Big L was a Harlem dude, and he was the first one in Harlem that was really doing it at that level.
Yeah, he was definitely going to Rockefeller, you know, but he wanted to make sure he didn't lose his buzz in the transition of signing paperwork or going back and forth with the paperwork.
My whole click season, we wrote the streets cause it's sick season. This ain't the time to have your wrist treason. I might put the big cat to your six pack. Quick clack, let me get that. Make it quick black, drop the chit chat. Why y'all flex? Knowing hot sucks to fry y'all flex. I tag the baggage like the IRS. I use the front that was really rich. You silly bitch, push woolly whips like a white rover. Front on Big L, your life's over. I brought my baby girl an ice choker. Catch a G and then I might smoke her. I make the right word split. I pimp these bitches like an ice world slip. And if I go to jail, I might serve 10.
I was waiting for L and D&D that night. I was waiting for L. I'm beeping him. Yeah, beepers packed in.
Yeah.
I'm calling him. I'm leaving voicemails. He's not getting back to me. And reason being was I had an idea, another idea, to do a record with him. And he wasn't getting back. So I got upset. Not upset, but I was mad. I'm like, that's not him, but, you know. So anyway, I go home. I hop in my whip. And I'm going through the Midtown Tunnel. And I'm still beeping him, calling him. He's not returning no calls. So fast forward, I get home, and my lady was like, yo, I came in the house, and she was teary-eyed. She wasn't boo-hooing, but I'm like, damn, she must have found a number or something. I was like, oh, I done fucked up. What I done did now? So when I got closer to her, that wasn't that vibe. And automatically, I was like, who's dead? And she was like, L. So the first thing that came to mind was Finesse. Both L's.
Yeah.
I was like, Ness? And she was like, nah. L, Big L, Show just called. And he's standing right, him and Joe was standing over his body in Harlem. Looking at his boots under the sheet and the tape and all that.
I was on my way to Atlantic City. And then I got the call while I was crossing a bridge, and I went down there, and L was just shot. He was, when they told me he was, when he got shot, I was crossing from the Bronx to Manhattan, and I just made the left.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went down there, he just was still laying on the floor.
Oh, you saw his body?
Yeah, I saw him there. I stood there. I saw him there. Yeah. Yeah, he was there.
Yeah.
That was like so left field. Like,
yeah.
That was so much of a shock because everybody knew like L was going to be that. We all knew like L was going to be the biggest guy one day.
Uh-huh.
Like, we all knew that. That was just without, you know, any doubt. But when he got killed, that just took us to, I know myself, I couldn't like, yeah, that just took me somewhere else.
Took you somewhere else.
Yeah, that just took me somewhere else because it was an unexpected. Like, and you know, L was funny and all of that, but, you know, we knew L was in the street.
Uh-huh.
We knew what L, you know, I knew at least.
Yeah.
You know, so I was just trying to figure out why, you know, what direction it came from.
Uh-huh.
But I never thought it was going to happen to him. Because so much love he had around his way.
Yeah.
He has so much love around his way. Like, I never thought that was going to happen.
If he was alive right now, he'd be a problem. Biggie, Tupac, everybody knew about Big L, and they definitely respected his skills and his contributions to hip-hop music and to the culture. And again, we had to carry it on so that it don't never die out.
I was in my mom's crib, and, you know, somebody called me like, yo, you heard that Big L just got killed uptown? I was like, nah. Like, I just, you know, kind of like spoke to him. The last thing he said to me was like, yo, I'm going to, you want to come with me to L.A.? I never been to L.A. at that time. So I was like, yeah. That was the last thing I heard from him. Last thing.
At that time, when he passed, it was just, I don't know. I mean, it was I don't even know how to explain that time in my life. I know it was a time where I just ain't really want to be bothered with music no more. Because I had just lost my grandmother and then lost this dude right behind my grandmother. So it was something like, I'm done.
Yeah, man.
I'm done.
Sorry to hear, man. This is too much.
And the love for music is always there. So I'm always going to be in music one way or another.
He wasn't what a lot of people think he was. He wasn't no crazy dude out in the street. He did a little things in the street, but what he basically was talking about was what he seen that was around him 24/7. You know what I mean? We did a lot of dirt and a lot of shit in these streets, man. You know what I mean? Can't take it back. But it is what it is, you know what I mean? And my brother did a whole lot of things out here. So Lamont used to really rap about things that was around him 24/7. Even from the jokester part of him, the slick talking part of him, everything that was around him. You know what I mean? The slick talking, the slick rhyming joint, the slick punchlines he got was from a lot of dudes that used to come around and floss and got
talk
that little
shit.
Slick talk shit about it, and he picked it all up and made it his own, you know what I mean? Even the heist joint. You know what I mean? It's just, man, it's, hell, I miss it.
You get on the dance floor and shake till your pants tore. Some party people clap your hands for the one they call Big L. I'm hot as hell, I'm living swell. My name's ringing bells, can't you tell? So grab the Moet and take a sip. I stay looking dip, mics are ripped, but don't flip. We on a party tip. I get so loose on tracks that I produce. MCs be fronting mad hard, but got no juice. I'm not the type that strikes out when I pull mics out. Violate L when it's lights out. And if you got no skills on the mic, you order dash. Cause rappers that sort of trash, the Big L slaughter fast. I'm getting high rates in all states, making papes with the crew